And I think we all know, especially when it comes to sales, there's usually 20% of the people who are doing 80% of the sales. And the goal is, if you can get some of the people in the 60% in that middle group who are doing okay, if you can get them to just up level just a little bit, that can be exponential growth for your business.
So this is a podcast for call centers, for inside telephone sales leaders, business owners, right? You know that. And in most of those situations, which you know, there's some kind of gamification in place. Usually the classic is, here's a spiff or a contest, close these deals or do this many phone calls today and I'll give you $5 or a lottery ticket, or I'll give you this, or you can win a TV. And you know, they're driving these incentives, whether it's daily, weekly, quarterly, monthly, you know, putting deals and stats on the whiteboard. Like, that's the classic, let's just say, gamification mode, even though, you know, it's not really in that sense. And of course, there's different apps, but let's talk about kind of your background, what you saw as a need for development for individuals, for companies, because while it's a platform for individuals now, you started in corporate life with Injoy, and, you know, where that makes the shift and helps people out the most.
Yeah, thank you. So, you know, when it comes to people, no matter what job they're in, and salespeople, you know, sales is tough. So there's an added layer of, you know, challenge and certain things that can support salespeople. But people fundamentally want four things to really engage and to bring their best self forward. And those four things across all industries and all professions are: they want to feel valued, they want to feel connected to others, they want to feel like what they're doing is contributing to a bigger picture, and they want to feel like they're growing professionally and personally over time, that they can stop and look back and say, I'm a better version of myself today than I was 6 months ago or a year ago. So why that's important is, to the degree that you can create that environment, you can bring out the best in your people. And I think we all know, especially when it comes to sales, there's usually 20% of the people who are doing 80% of the sales. And the goal is, if you can get some of the people in the 60% in that middle group who are doing okay, if you can get them to just up level just a little bit, that can be exponential growth for your business. So when you're catering to what our basic fundamental needs are to bring our best self forward, it's much easier to, you know, elevate the masses, not just your top performers, but everybody, so that you get maximum performance from all of your team members.
Well, and I love that approach, because I see a lot of leaders in organizations, let's say sales leaders, sales managers, just focusing on that top group or trying to find more of the top group, right? That 20% that are doing 80% of the deals, the work. But you're right. I mean, if you can move the middle up even just a little bit, maybe they're never going to be the superstars, but if they can do better, if they can do better consistently, right? Because one of the things is, sales, you see a lot of people go up and down, which is tough on the business, tough on the person, mentally, emotionally, morale for the team. If you can even just even out the ups and downs, like over a day or a week or a month, whatever that cycle is, then I've seen that have huge differences for the organization on the bottom line.
Absolutely. So, I mean, can I just, to your point,
yeah, please.
You know, a lot of times if people would analyze what's differentiating the great from the good, it's consistency. The great are performing consistently over time, not just having one good month or one good week. They're consistently performing. So I think for when it comes to sales, we always have to just kind of back up and look at it and say, what's different between this group and this group? And really, it's not the training. Everyone's getting the same training. It's not the tools. Everyone has access to the same tools. So what is it? And oftentimes, if you ask the top salespeople, what are you doing different? It's just like, well, I do these things every day. I do, you know, and they've got a ritual and they've made them habits. And that's what we found, is we can help people create new habits, which typically is very hard. But if you can, then people get the benefit of up-leveling themselves, and they can see that in real time, because it's usually behavior is the precursor to performance, right? So if we can just get them to do the behaviors that all modeling, that's Tony Robbins's big deal. If we could model more of the behavior of your top performers, then everyone, you know, then that'll raise everyone's game, even though they might not ever be that top person. They might not, they can all get better. We can all get better.
So how have you found, obviously with the platform that you've built, but where does that help build those habits and the discipline, especially in terms of, you know, the classic debate of how many days it takes to build a habit, right?
Yeah.
21, 30, 66, 100, never, you know, how have you approached that with your background and then what you've seen work?
Yeah, I think it's important to realize there's a lot of numbers thrown out there in terms of how long it takes to form a habit. But the reality is, if anyone's ever started going to the gym and that was a commitment, it doesn't matter if you went for 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks, if you stop going, you've lost it, right? Like there's a lot of times I was a runner for a while. I ran every day for years. Now I don't run. I don't have that as a habit. Like we can, so the point of this is personal development and professional development is an ongoing game, right? It's something that we do have to look at making incremental changes that we can actually continue long-term. And the day we stop doing them, we're at risk of backtracking, right? So it is like working out. We can't go to the gym one time in January and feel like we're going to be in shape for the rest of the year. This is something that we have to make it a part of our daily routine. And that's why we use, you know, challenges as a way to get people into the momentum of seeing what's possible. And once they start to get a taste of a better them, better results, like that's its own reward, right? So we use a lot of tricks on the front end to trick the brain, to make it easy to start doing something new that we weren't doing yesterday, because that can be uncomfortable regardless of how good it is for us. But once we start to see the benefit of that, and we have some encouragement, we have all that environmental support that I mentioned earlier, that people are feeling valued for their efforts, they're seeing that they're connected to others, they're not alone. They're seeing that what they're doing, no matter how small or how new they are, is contributing to a bigger picture, and that they're growing. When that happens, they want more of that. And as they want more of that, they continue to do what got them that feeling in the first place, which gives them the best chance of creating a lifelong practice and habit, if that makes sense. So it's not just, again, doing something for, we do 30-day challenges and then you're done and you're good forever. Most of our successful clients do a challenge every quarter. They give, you know, they have a way that people can get engaged, start practicing, see if they can keep it going on their own. And then they give them another dose the next quarter. And as that continues, people do find themselves ebbing and flowing, but less. They start to see like, oh, I'm going to keep this, and they can keep that habit longer. And they fall back shallower. Like they don't lose as much when they're off, then they come back in better. So it's an ongoing process is what I want to, you know, just want to mention.